Hello, everybody. I'm Stephanie Allenda, the chair of the CPS. I would like to welcome to our presenter, discussion, and welcome everyone who have joined us for this third session of our permanent seminar, CPS Talks with Authors, co-organized by the Research Committee on Political Sociology and our Faculty of Education and Social Sciences at Andres Bello University. This seminar is also sponsored by the International Sociological Association and the International Political Science Association, by the Vice Rectory for Research of Andres Bello University and the Global Network of Women Political Scientists. As you may know already, the CPS invites one or more authors once a month to present their latest book in about 25 minutes. Each presentation is followed by a 10 to 15 minutes discussion led by expert scholars on the subject, and the discussion is then open to the public for around 15 minutes. Today, we are honored to have Jennifer Piscopo with us, Associate Professor of Politics at Occidental College in Los Angeles, California, and member of the Network of Women Political Scientists. Also, Jennifer is a leading expert on women and electoral politics. In this seminar, she will present her recent book, The Right to be Elected, 100 Years Since Suffrage, co-edited with Shauna Shames, which will then receive a more or less 15-minute comments from Julieta Suárez-Cao, an associate professor at the Political Science Institute of Catholic University here in Santiago, also coordinator of the Network of Women Political Scientists, and also secretary and treasurer of the CPS. This book makes reference to the Chilean referendum for the Chilean case in general, and the approval of a parity convention as a result of the October 2020 referendum for a new constitution. And so we couldn't have found a more adequate discussant than Julieta Suárez, who played a crucial role in pushing for the adoption of the bill which established gender parity in the constitutional process. But the book deals more centrally with the barriers to more gender balance in politics, both through gender quotas and gender parity. In particular, in the US, despite important advances in this matter all over the world since the 90s, including the recent election, of course, of Kamala Harris as vice president in the US. Well, let's explore those issues with your presentation, Jennifer, and thanks again for having accepted our invitation. I'll leave you the floor.
Well, thank you so much, Stephanie. Thank you, Julieta. Thank you to the International Political Science Association, the International Sociological Association, and of course, the Universidad de Andres Bello for having me today. It's really fun for me. So I'm really excited to share this work with you. And I do have a PowerPoint to launch. So here we go. Right. So I'm going to present the book, which is The Right to be Elected, and I want to talk about rethinking women's political inclusion in the 21st century. And before I launch into the book, I wanted to start with my own research and a little bit about how this project came about. And so there have been recent and extraordinary gains in terms of women's election to political office across the globe. And so here I put the proportion of women in Latin America's lower or unicameral chambers from 1990 to 2020. And so you can see this jump in about 20 percentage points in just 30 years in terms of women holding political power. And Latin America is extraordinary in this sense, in terms that it has made the most sustained numeric advances, but Latin America is not alone. And if we look globally, what explains these jumps is that starting in 1991, when Argentina was the first country in the world to adopt a gender quota law, mandating that 30% of candidates be women, 75 countries have since followed, and they have some form of gender quota law, either requiring political parties to run certain proportions of women or reserving seats in parliament for women. And right now in 2021, thanks to these gender quota laws, about 36 countries have more than 35% women in their parliament. So gender quotas are unquestionably the most popular and the most dramatic electoral reform of the late 20th and early 21st century. And so my research has really centered on understanding how quotas became adopted, why it matters that gender quotas are in place, not just in terms of women's numeric gains, but in terms of broader policy implications. And I focused on Latin America and the trends elsewhere. So this was what was in my mind, this recent extraordinary gains in terms of women's election to political office, when the United States started thinking about the US suffrage centennial. So in the United States, women received the federal right to vote, meaning the US Constitution was amended to give all women the right to vote in 1920. So in 2020, the US celebrated 100 years of the women's right to vote. And so the Boston Review, which is a political and literary press, so this is a press aimed at mainstream, not academic audiences. So in 2019, an editor from the Boston Review approached me and they said, you know, we want to do a volume to commemorate women's suffrage, but we want a fresh take on 100 years of US women exercising their right to vote. So what's the fresh take? And they were looking for pitches. And so as I just mentioned, right, I'm a scholar not of women's right to vote, but of women's political representation. And so I'm thinking about these dramatic gains in women's access to elected office in Latin America and in other countries. And so my thought was, well, why are we still talking about the right to vote, right? And what strikes me as somebody who actually is a US citizen and grew up and lives in the United States is it's really clear in the US when we think about suffrage, we are thinking about the right to vote. And I love this cartoon, one of the many illustrations celebrating the commemoration of US women's suffrage, again, emphasizing the connectivity between women's right to vote 100 years ago and women's right to vote today. Because of course we know that women, especially women of color, still face barriers to voting. But if I think about the context that I study, suffrage is often not portrayed as just the right to vote, but as the right to elect, that's the right to vote, and the right to be elected. And when I think about how countries have motivated gender quota laws, especially in Latin America, they've done so by appealing to the right to elect and be elected. And to illustrate that, I put here this infographic put out by Mexico's Electoral Institute in 2020, saying, todas las mexicanas tenemos el derecho a ser elegidas para cualquier cargo público. Every Mexican woman has the right to be elected to any political office. So I thought, these are really some contrasting views about women's political rights. The United States, the dialogue centered on the right to vote, and elsewhere, the dialogue centered on not just the right to vote, but the right to be elected. So my pitch to the Boston Review was to say, well, you know, it's the centennial of women's suffrage, but the US only ranks 76th in the globe when it comes to electing women to office. This was the ranking in 2020. So we settled on an approach to the volume, and the idea was, if the women's vote was the battle of the 20th century, then women's representation, meaning gaining power by holding political office, will be the battle of the 21st. So the volume was put together, and the volume consists of an introduction that I co-authored with Shauna Shames. And then in the introduction, we talk about why does democracy need women? Why should we care about having women in elected office? The main part of the volume is what the Boston Review calls the forum, which is the central essay. And that is the piece that I wrote centered on the right to be elected. Then the volume also includes some responses from colleagues, both political scientists and those who are working in the area of practice and policy. And then finally, a conclusion that I also wrote, revisiting the theme of the right to be elected and the responses from the colleagues. So I won't be able to talk about every aspect of this, but I want to dive into what I do in that central essay focused on a right to be elected. So in the central essay, I try to do three things. I try to offer an intellectual history of where the right to be elected came from. Why is the right to be elected missing from the US Constitution? Why does the US Constitution only talk about a right to vote? And then I want to identify the normative and the political consequences in the United States of understanding suffrage as merely the right to vote. And so by contrast, I talk about how feminist and women's movements elsewhere in the globe successfully pushed their countries to elect more women by using a language of a right to be elected, and then how the US fell behind. So in my remaining time, I'll try to give some snapshots for each of these three arguments. So I started out with this question of where did a right to be elected come from? And I really have to acknowledge a lot of the historians and constitutional legal scholars that put up with some pestering questions for me back in 2019. So I'm really thankful for their patience. And so as far as I was able to reconstruct, the 1812 Spanish Constitution defined suffrage as the right to elect and be elected. And this 1812 Spanish Constitution was the model for the constitutions that then were adopted by the newly independent republics in Spanish and Portuguese-speaking America. And so the derecho de elegir y ser elegido, which came from Spain, then got incorporated into Latin America's new constitutions. But what's really important here is that these definitions of citizenship as the right to, as exercising the right to elect and be elected, were not designed to be inclusionary. They were not being used as women and feminist movements would start to use them 80 years later when they argued for political rights and gender quotas. Back in the 19th century, these definitions of who can elect and be elected were about restricting political rights, about drawing lines between citizens and non-citizens. So citizens who met certain qualifications, being men, holding property, being literate, were able to hold political office and choose those who would hold political office, and non-citizens, women, children, indigenous, and Afro-descendant people, could not. So the initial impetus for codifying in constitutions a right to elect and a right to be elected was to exclude and to draw boundaries around citizenship. Now, this language did not get incorporated into the United States Constitution in 1787. But there was an interesting historic moment that I reconstruct in the essay around the Reconstruction Amendments after the US Civil War. So for our international audience, right, the US fought the Civil War over slavery in the mid-1800s, and Reconstruction was the period after the Civil War when several amendments were added to the US Constitution to grant citizenship to the former enslaved population. And so what's critical here was the 15th Amendment to the US Constitution that was added in 1870. And you can see here that this amendment removes voting restrictions based on race and former condition of enslavement, right? So this was enfranchising the United States' former slaves. And I reconstruct in the essay a moment where there actually was an impetus in the drafting of the 15th Amendment to introduce language of the right to elect and be elected into that amendment. It seemed to be the case that lawmakers thought that voting rights in the US tacitly implied a right to be elected. And so there was a small moment where that could have been codified in the 15th Amendment, but there were broader concerns about adding too much permissiveness into the 15th Amendment that would then make the states that still resisted the extension of rights to enslaved people be likely to reject that amendment. So the amendment opted for the most straightforward language possible to ensure passage. And so you see here that it's just stating that the right of US citizens to vote shall not be abridged on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude, passed in 1870. This is also important because another argument that I make in the essay is about the distinction between negative and positive rights and how that matters for differing conceptions of suffrage. So you see that the language here is that the right to vote cannot be denied or abridged by the state. So this is a framing of political rights, the right to vote, perhaps the right to be elected, as negative. And we think about negative rights as meaning the state's obligation is simply to not interfere with the exercise of that right. And so 50 years later, when the 19th Amendment is adopted to the US Constitution, you see that same negative language. The right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States on account of sex. So again, the state cannot interfere with someone's right to vote, first because of their race or color, and then 50 years later in 1920 because of their sex. And so when we think about political rights as negative rights, the obligation on behalf of the state to help citizens exercise their rights is very minimal. And so I took a deep dive to see if in US legal history, there had ever been any kind of legal questions about the state's obligation vis-a-vis candidacy, not just voting, but vis-a-vis candidacy. And the cases that I found came about in the 1960s when there were some legal challenges in the United States to how a candidate could put himself or herself on the ballot. So the US Supreme Court did intervene in some cases around ballot access, stating that certain city or state laws regulating conditions for accessing the ballot were too burdensome for candidates. So we do, in the United States, have a right to become a candidate, a right to put your name on the ballot, but again, it's constructed as a negative right. The state can't put so many regulations on becoming a candidate, such as to be burdensome. But what I argue in the essay is that this negative idea of political rights is very different from saying that the state has an affirmative obligation to help people become candidates. It's simply the case that the state cannot get in your way. And so in this period in the 1960s, we see the US women's movement taking aim at many of the legal barriers that prevent women from having equal access to opportunities and jobs, that prevent women from, say, having credit cards or bank accounts in their own names rather than their husband's names. But again, the focus is on removing the barriers to opportunity, not requiring that the state do anything else to facilitate opportunity. And so I draw a contrast between this idea of political rights and citizenship rights more broadly as negative in the United States to some of the different kinds of conversations that are happening in other countries. And so I can't recapitulate all of those conversations, but to make this contrast between negative and positive rights stronger, for instance, in 1988 in Costa Rica, they passed the law for the promotion of social equality of women. And what this law does, in contrast to simply getting out of the way, is it starts to lay out a set of affirmative, positive obligations for the state to hurry along women's ability to catch up in terms of men when it comes to their access to education, to economic employment, and to politics. And of course, if we think about Latin America, the broader context in the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and the 90s is the struggle to democratize and the importance of democracy creating norms around inclusion and participation, and the argument that women's presence is essential for democracy, and that if the state produces democracy, and if women's presence is essential for democracy, then the state is obligated, again, to move history forward, to take affirmative or positive steps rather than simply get out of the way. And so the essay starts to draw on some of my earlier research, focusing on the way that states have actually positioned themselves as gender equality guarantors when it comes to enforcing women's political rights. And this is part of the story of how gender quotas and recently gender parity become popular in Latin America and in other countries. So I argue that if we, meaning in the United States, were to think about political rights as positive rights rather than negative rights, we are able to understand how some of the arguments that were made by women and feminists elsewhere in the globe gained traction in their home countries. So what does it mean to reframe political rights as positive rights? The arguments that are made here is that descriptive representation is a legitimate basis of representation. So let's think for a moment about how countries elect Congress or Parliament. Usually the basis for representation is territorial, right? I'm a resident of Los Angeles in California, and so I cast my ballot for a representative to come from Los Angeles or to come from California and speak for me in the federal government. So that's territorial representation. But descriptive representation says, well, there's other grounds on representation. I could be represented by someone who shares other identity features, such as someone who is a woman, or someone who is white, right, who shares my racial identity. And so descriptive representation matters, specifically the descriptive representation of groups that have been historically excluded because of their group identity. So actually, descriptive representation isn't for any identity, right? It's not for having curly hair, it's not for being short, but it's for having those kinds of identities that have been systematically, historically defined as not citizens. Women, people of color, indigenous peoples, Afro-descendants, the former enslaved. And so it's thinking then that if groups are excluded based on their identity, that this is a collective harm that befalls the group, and that the group then is entitled to the state taking action to ameliorate that harm. And so the solution is, of course, inclusion. And the solution, if we're thinking about women, is then what are the grounds for inclusion? What are the grounds for descriptive representation? And so you see here the argument that's made, and the argument that many have made, including Julieta, is that if women are half the population, then they should be descriptively represented as half the representatives. So that would be the idea of gender parity. And so these arguments, and I make this point in the essay, are making justice-based claims to women's descriptive representation and justice-based claims to discrimination, excuse me, to representation, right? In other words, women are excluded as a historic wrong, and so justice entails placing women in to right historic wrongs. That's often not the argument that's made in practice for things like gender quotas and gender parity, right? Often people want to know, well, do women make a difference? And will politics and policy change if women are present? So I call those consequence-based arguments rather than justice-based arguments. So consequence-based arguments are often sexier in practice, they're more appealing. But what I note in the essay is that when gender quotas and gender parity were challenged as being unconstitutional, as they were throughout Latin America and in Europe and in Asia, it was the justice-based claims that prevailed. And one of the cases I love to cite is in Costa Rica, where the Costa Rican Constitutional Court actually developed a doctrine of what they called compensatory inequalities, meaning treating women as unequal, meaning giving them an advantage in running for office, was justified because it was compensating for past harms and past discrimination. So this, what I suggest in the essay, is a very different approach to understanding political rights. It has allowed other countries to adopt and implement gender quotas and gender parity, and it explains those trends that have let other countries jump over the United States. So I suggest that there's been a global inversion in the last 100 years in which countries are succeeding in enforcing women's political rights. So here's a map made by Uruguayan suffragist Paulina Luisi in 1929 to argue for women's right to vote and right to be elected in Uruguay. And so you can see here, she's suggesting, where do women have political rights? And she says women have political rights in North America because by 1920, US women had the right to vote. They have political rights in Europe, but they don't have political rights in what we would now call the countries of the global South, Latin America and Africa. So suffrage happens, and then, as I talk about in the essay, this second generation of understanding women's political right to be elected happens, and gender quotas take off. So here's the map showing women in politics based on their political representation in 2020. The color coding's a little bizarre, but blue and purple are good, okay? So look at where we see blue and purple. We see a lot of blue and purple in Central and South America. We see a lot of blue and purple in Africa. A flip from the map that Paulina Luisi made almost 100 years ago. We see now countries that said, well, women don't have any political rights 100 years ago, doing much better than some of the global North countries when it comes to electing women to political office. So in the essay, I draw the contrast between thinking about gender quotas and gender parity as a form of reparations to women for historic exclusion, and in the United States, by contrast, thinking about women's candidacy as something women just have to figure out for themselves. So Latin American feminists emphasize the state's obligation to compensate for past discrimination, winning gender quotas and gender parity. But in the US, the narrative is very much on, well, women just need to figure out how to run for office. They just need to work harder. So you see narratives like this. The problem in the US is not women actually being able to run, it's not being able to win, it's that women just don't want to run. And I talk in this essay and in my other research about how the dangers of this do-it-yourself frame mean that the problem of women's underrepresentation then becomes framed not as something that's systematic, that's a product of discrimination, but as something that is just women's fault, right? You see it here. Women just don't want to run. They don't have enough ambition. They don't know how to raise money. They're too loud. They're too abrasive. And so, of course, we actually see quite a lot of women running for office. Here's five of the women that sought the Democratic nomination for president in 2020, but we all know what happened to their candidacies. So the argument there here ultimately is that achieving more women in political office requires structural change. It requires thinking about systems of power, not just thinking about how women can be better candidates. And I don't have time to talk about some of the other contributions to this volume, but I want to underscore Dawn Teal's essay, because I thought that she really introduced a broader element of structural considerations than I did. And she points out that while women's public roles have changed, their private roles have not. So she says, so long as working women bear the brunt of the emotional, physical, and cognitive labor in the home, women will never have the intellectual space or the free time to participate fully in politics. Now, this essay was written before Kamala Harris was picked as Biden's running mate and then became vice president. And it was written in the production process before the pandemic. But it is impossible to read Dawn's quote and, of course, not think about the fact that in the past year, COVID-19 has made this reality plain. It has really pulled back so much of our conversation that we have centered on women's individual choices and made us realize how much is actually structural. And so in the very conclusion of the volume, I go back to this notion of structural change. I go back to this idea of what gender quotas and gender parity have meant in other countries. And I point out that it's not simply requiring that women be better candidates or that women be better politicians, that they change their tone of voice or that they stop doing housework. But actually, when we talk about political power, it is a zero-sum game. There are only so many positions to go around. And what gender quotas and gender parity ultimately do, and why they are also so contested, is that they ask some men to step aside. So I ended the volume by saying that women who are long excluded should receive access and influence, not just because they spent decades hammering at the gates of power, not just because they kept trying harder, but because the gatekeepers themselves walked right out and made room. So men, it's been a good run, but it's time to step aside. So I appeal then to the global advances in normative politics, normative principles, and women's political rights throughout the essay, pointing out that since the 1970s, feminist and women's movements have reshaped global understandings of political rights. It's time for the US to catch up. And at this moment, in a COVID moment, it is also time for all countries to protect the gains that they made. So thank you so much. I really look forward to your questions and your comments.
Thanks a lot, Jennifer, for this great presentation, very clear and very interesting, which allows us to understand the national specificities, the political configurations, dynamics, structural configuration, all of that, that contribute to explain the different levels of advancement of the inclusion of women in politics. We will now listen to Julieta's comments, and I forgot to say that you can already leave your questions in our chat and I will read them at the end of this activity.
Thank you, Stephanie, for the floor. Thank you for the invitation to Andrés Bello University, International Political Science Association, the International Sociological Association, Red de Politólogas, and of course, thank you, Jennifer, for this wonderful presentation. Forgive me the opportunity to read the book, because you know in this pandemic life you need to be pushed to read other things that you would love to read in a normal time, but I think this was wonderful. I enjoy the book enormously. I recommend it to everyone. They think everyone should read it because the book is an honest discussion. It's a horizontal brainstorming in a way that I think tries to answer a question that is broader. That's, I don't know, I don't want to be crass, but it's, what is wrong with the United States? What is wrong in America that so few women have rich influence in politics? So I found it from the Global South like extremely interesting and honest. It was like an honest discussion about women and politics in the US. The book constructs very well what I would call like the pyramid of women's underrepresentation, of women's exclusion. On the apex, we have quotas, parity, affirmative action for descriptive representation, everything that Jen has been so clear recently explaining that how it works in Latin America and elsewhere, but not in the United States. In the middle, we have these stereotypes that are like these barriers that have impact on unconscious biases, individual biases, but also how the game is played, no? How the media portrays candidates, how people think about power and stereotype of what is to be a good leader, and those tend to be more masculine traits rather than feminine traits. And then on the bottom, we have what Don Teal and Jen talks about, the care work, like the origin of all inequality for women, this social contract that Carol Pateman said, this sexual contract that is on the basis of that women are dedicated to household duty, to domestic duty, to reproduction labor, and men are designed to be in the public sphere doing productive labor. So care work, and as Jennifer was saying, especially this year, it has shown how unequal it still is all around the world, the burden on women and all types of care work. I like one of the essays that says the battle of women's representations will be won or lost at our homes. We must reform the household economy so that no one gender is primarily responsible for it. And I would agree with this. I think probably like every feminist would agree with this. But I felt, I read between the lines that it was something that you could try to topple the whole building by attacking its foundation, this unequal distribution of work, care work. But it seems that in Latin America, we've just been like fixing the roof, speaking about like quotas and parity. But I don't think that's a fair account. I think the apex of the pyramid of women's exclusion has also an impact, or has the possibility to impact both gender stereotyping and care work. Regarding stereotypes, many of the authors already agree that seeing women in position of power tend to weaken not only stereotypes of women seen as less fit to rule, but also other important side effects as improving women's participation or turnout, especially also with minority women in power. And there we can also see this beneficial side effect that legislation starts benefiting more disadvantaged groups. So in a way, I think the roof is almost as important as the foundations. In Chile, we are about to have a constitutional assembly with gender parity, thanks to institutional engineering and reserve seats for indigenous people. And now the conversation, many proposals are dealing with the need of having co-responsible policies and a state's provision to recognize and to pay for care work. To care work, as real work, not just something that we do out of love because we are mothers and wives and daughters of people who need care. So I don't know whether we're going to be able to get all of this, but it isn't a conversation. People are talking about the need for a state that cares, un estado cuidador. So it has been said, it is reflected upon how we can change that unequal burden on women's shoulder for all the care work. So I don't know if I agree with the pessimistic tone of many of the essays. Not Jennifer, because she's a Latin American, so she knows how it works here. But about the future of legislative quotas or parity or mandated parity across government at all territorial level in the U.S. The U.S. invented affirmative action. So why not quotas? I would love to pick on Jen's brain about this. I know, and it is said, and I know for sure that it is a fact that political parties don't control nominations. This is true, but we can change it or not. I wonder what you think about this. It is also said that it is against the culture, no? But as my friend and colleague Javier Arce always reminds me, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women says clearly that governments should modify the social and cultural patterns of conduct of men and women with a view to achieving the elimination of prejudices and customary and all other practices which are based on the idea of the inferiority of women. So if it is the culture that oppresses, we need to change the culture. And I think we can do that. I'm very agentic today. I don't know why I'm so optimistic. But culture is not an excuse for keep oppressing women or any other disempowered group for the matter. And it shouldn't be in the 21st century. Finally, I would like to underline something that I find really interesting about the American case. And it is the role of these grassroots initiatives like Emily's List or She Should Run, all these groups that are formed around women to recruit them, to train them, as well as to fund their political campaigns. On a football, I always am a little bit uncomfortable with this idea that women need to be trained, like as dogs, but political and female politicians need to be trained. I would argue that male politicians need to be trained too. Like your former president probably needed to be trained too. And I would love to see a lot of grassroots initiatives for training men in being better politicians. And not only in the U.S., I'm speaking for Latin American as well too. It's this idea that only women need to be coached and trained to enter politics. Well, I would argue that men need that too. ASAP. But I think Jennifer puts the finger on when it says about all these grassroots initiatives around recruiting and funding women's campaign, but a narrative exerting to lean in still implies that women's deficiency are what keep them out and that the burden of solving the problems falls to them. So the solution of teaching women how to play the game in an unleveled field looks problematic to me because its individual focus can help blurring the structural constraints, can help blurring the very same fact that the playing field is an unlevel field. And I think I would like to know what you think about this, but I think this is just another example of the difference of feminist struggles between the global north and the global south, or at least the United States and Latin America. I remember a New Yorker piece by Judith Butler, and she was arguing that Latin American feminism, like the Ni Una Menos movement in Argentina, Mexico, Chile, it's a movement that visibilizes protests against femicides and achieved important legal, I would argue, and cultural changes, as Jennifer probably well knows. But it draws on like collective understandings of on women's problematic, on women's issues. Whereas in the U.S., I would argue that maybe the hashtag MeToo movement is more like an individualized frame. I agree with that, but there is a difference. There is a politically relevant difference in understanding political struggle as an individual endeavor or as a collective endeavor. I cannot stress more the importance of reading this book, and not only for American people. I enjoy it a lot. It made me think a lot and reflect about the differences and similarities. And I would love to go to the U.S. and say, come on, you can do it. I was reading on Twitter many male political scientists talking about the need for electoral reform in the U.S. So there was, oh, we should move to an open, openly proportional representation system. No, we should move to a ranked choice order. None of them mentioned quotas. It was a long thread, of comments from all male political scientists talking about the need of electoral reform in the U.S. No one said a bit about women's representation. So I think there's an opportunity there, and I would love to see my female colleagues, my women colleagues in the U.S. Political scientists being involved in this conversation and saying, we need electoral reform, but we need more than that. We also need affirmative action in these electoral reforms to keep pushing, moving up. And as Jen perfectly said, men should also step aside. In order to do this, we need to make room. And unfortunately, this is a zero-sum game. So you have to go to work and take care of the babies. So, this is a wonderful book. You should all read it. It was really enjoying. I was really enjoyed by reading it. And I think it paints a clear picture of what keeps women from enjoying the right to be elected. And if you listen to the whole Jennifer presentation and this quick comment, I would say, spoiler alert, it's not the women's fault. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Julieta, for your provocative and very positive comments, which raise the question of the conditions of possibility of more significant changes and advances in the U.S., considering the individualistic culture of the U.S., but also taking into account the recent election in the U.S. Jennifer, you can take 5 minutes to respond to Julieta's comments.
Thank you so much, Julieta, for your comments. So much to think about. I'll try to respond to sort of what I thought were three big arcs in your comments. So the first on care work. And the pandemic has been an absolute tragedy. And so I don't want to minimize that tragedy. But in the long run, I do think one silver-ish lining, right, because I don't want to sound like I'm minimizing the tragedy, has been that the pandemic has changed the political and policy conversation around care work. And I think it's really helpful to contrast the economic downturn that COVID has triggered compared to the economic downturn in the 2008-2009 global financial crisis. Because what we saw in the 2008-2009 financial crisis was that most of the job losses sustained in that crisis were among men, right? And they were among these sort of upper status positions in finance. So we didn't have the kinds of conversations that we are having now in 2020 because COVID is different, right? Most job losses under COVID have been among women, and economies will actually not be able to restart unless women return to the workforce. So countries, whether they're in the global south or the global north, they cannot ignore the economic value of women's labor the way they could have during the 2008-2009 financial crisis when women's job losses were not targeted as severely. And so I think that is changing the conversation around care work. I mean, just this week, the Deputy Prime Minister of Canada, the Minister of Finance, Chrystia Freeland, announced $30 billion Canadian dollars to create a national child care system. So I think that this conversation is going to be fundamental, and I do think there's a lot of reason for optimism. We're also talking about a national child care system in the United States, and even 10 years ago, such a conversation would be unthinkable. So I think that will have enormous ramifications for gender equality, not just in politics. So yes, care work is work. I think the second comment, and I get this a lot, why not quotas in the United States? And I'm so sorry, Microsoft Teams just did some things that, okay, great, sorry, I couldn't see my screen anymore. So why not quotas in the United States, right? And so the classic answer, as Julieta mentioned, is that the U.S. is peculiar in so many ways, and one of the ways in which we're peculiar is that the political parties don't control candidate selection. And so it's much easier to have a gender quota when political parties control candidate selection because the regulation is essentially a rule about what the parties must do when they go to register their candidates. But as Julieta said, there, you can change that, right? That's a political change. And so I think we get to the US's sort of second set of peculiarities. And I call, and it's a set because there's two items. One, political reform of any kind is very difficult in the United States. We do have a culture around the Constitution that's quite different relative to other countries that are much more willing to innovate and think creatively about constitutional reforms. So of course, my argument in the essay is we can think innovatively and creatively too, but there's a real sort of deification of the Constitution among many constituents in the United States. So the United States does not have an Equal Rights Amendment. We do not have any constitutional amendment that says that women and men have equal rights. The Equal Rights Amendment to the Constitution has been languishing. I mean, I can go into depth on this, but it's been languishing for 50 years. We cannot get a critical mass of ratification. Julieta, you mentioned CEDA. The United States is one of three countries that has not ratified the CEDA Convention. We share that honor with South Sudan, which is usually not what we think of as a bedfellow of the United States, right? So this resistance to using law and reforming laws to create the basis for not just negative rights, but positive rights is some sort of, I will actually say, pathology in the United States. I think the second element that can't be separated from this, the second peculiarity or second set of peculiarities, is our legacy of enslavement. And that makes conversations around quotas and reparations very difficult. Because even if they're framed around benefits for women, because we have a strong conservative tradition with a lot of political power, there is deep fear among those of opening up the gates for talking about quotas and broader forms of reparations to our Black population. Now, I think those conversations are essential and need to happen, but if I put my political realist hat on, that's part of the resistance, right? If we open the doors to women, we have to reckon with our deeply racist past. The United States is not the only country to have a racist past, but we have really struggled to acknowledge and reckon with that past relative to other countries. So I think those are some of the kind of embedded, pathological, even psychological obstacles for a lot of US voters and citizens when they think about quotas. And then finally, 1,000% do I agree on this, the problematic space that women's training programs operate, right? Because you know, when I work with individual women candidates, whether it's in Latin America or the United States, you know, it's quite clear that women want these training programs. You know, they sign up and register in droves. There's in fact not enough training programs to go around. And I think part of that is because what the training programs deliver as a good to women across the globe is they offer women networks of support and solidarity on the difficult quest to seek political office, and that those networks are deeply important. But at the structural level, right, these trainings continue to send the message that it's simply women that aren't good enough, right? And I think actually then women want the trainings because it gives them a certification to say to the political party, I've been trained, you don't get to say that I'm not good enough. But it does continue to send this message that we need to fix women in order to have more women in politics, when we quite know that, as you pointed out, there's many, many mediocre men politicians who also don't know how to do their jobs very well. So I think the training programs are problematic, but they do bring some benefits, and it's hard to think about how to thread that needle. Right. You know, that I don't want to knock programs that empower women because I'm a feminist, but I also want to be critical of some of the broader messages that they're sending.
Well, we have now some questions. The first question we have is from Ramesh Kumar from the India, who is a CPS member, who asked, what was the criteria consideration for selecting this topic? Maybe you could group questions. I could read some of the questions and you make a general answer. Catherine Reyes-Aushalder from Chile says, this is fascinating. So from this intellectual history of the concept of the right to be elected, how would you explain why it took Chile so long to adopt gender quotas? Then Deborah Tome thanks for this great event. I would like to ask a little bit more about this difference you made about the advocacy made by feminists in US and Latin America about women's participation in politics as candidates. Then a question of Jeanne Simon from the University of Concepcion. At different points in time, and especially when the US Congress is dysfunctional, there is a jump in women representatives. How should we conceptualize these gains, but then loss of descriptive representation? Javier Arce, the last question, why hasn't the US signed the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women? We have many questions and 10 to 15 minutes, no more.
Great, thank you so much for these questions. I'll try to answer all of them, and please, Stephanie, hold me accountable if I miss any. So I was taking them down in the order that they were read. You know, so for the topic, I mean, this project really emerged out of the commemoration of 100 years of US women's suffrage in the United States, right? And so we all know that countries like to have their centennials and their bicentennials. And so since 2020 was the commemoration of 100 years of women's suffrage, you know, different presses were looking for different ways to continue this conversation in the public sphere. And so that's how this topic came about for me. And you know, it was really a book that was aimed at a popular audience and not an academic audience, and trying to bring some of these conversations to the popular audiences. I lied, I won't go in order. So why has the US not ratified CEDA, Javier? I would say, you know, the primary opposition in the United States, there's sort of historical reasons and there's contemporary reasons, right? I mean, we have to, so historically, right, you know, CEDAW was in 1979. The US was sort of reluctant to open up itself to UN criticism on human rights and women's rights in the 1980s. You could imagine the context of the global, right, the context of the Cold War, the context of the discussion around human rights and women's rights, communism versus capitalism. And of course, at the same time, the US is actively suppressing the political rights of our Black population. And so the US was sort of reluctant to open itself up to UN scrutiny, and I think also the religious opposition and the concern that CEDA would require the United States to support abortion, right? And so we have a strong religious conservative tradition in the United States, and so those groups are quite powerful and do not want to norm any international conventions that might open the doors to that. And actually, my colleague Lisa Valdez has a great book where she goes in depth into the geopolitical and religious issues surrounding CEDA in the United States. The question about jumps in women's political representation. So this is fabulous. Thank you so much for this question. So thinking about the United States, right? When did the United States see two big jumps in women running as political candidates? So, you know, if you think there's a trend line, right? And then the trend line spikes. So the first trend line was in 1992. What was the original, we called it the Year of the Women. Why was there a jump in 1992? Well, that was the year that a Black woman law professor named Anita Hill spoke out against who was then a nominee for the Supreme Court, Justice Clarence Thomas, and accused him of sexual harassment. And she went before an all-male, all-white House Judiciary Committee, Senate Judiciary Committee, excuse me, and tried to explain her experiences with sexual harassment under Justice Thomas, and was sort of treated abominably. Like, this was the first eruption of sexual harassment as a public political issue in the United States. And so there was this sense that if only more women had been in Congress, Professor Hill would have been treated differently, perhaps Justice Thomas would not have been confirmed, and we saw a spike of women running for office. The second Year of the Women was, of course, 2018, following the election of Donald Trump. And we saw, again, a spike in the number of women in reaction to the Trump presidency. So my colleagues and I actually have a paper, so watch this space, on these two moments. And what we argue is that these are particular moments where the exclusion of women was actually mobilizing, right? We tend to think that we need more women in political office because women, for many reasons, among which women serve as role models, right? And that if young women see women in office, they'll see being a politician as something that they can do and they'll be more likely to run. But in fact, the 2 years of the women, 1992 and 2018, show us something different. They show us that moments of exclusion can be mobilizing for women. And we know that often at moments when group rights are under threat, that people will mobilize in response. When I give talks to US audiences, I often use those two examples to suggest that's not a great way to increase the number of women in politics, right? Like, we shouldn't be relying on threats and scandals, right, in order to inspire women to run for office. So theoretically, it's nice that we have this mechanism of exclusion, but I often contrast a kind of scandal-related or threat-related model to increasing women's candidacy to, say, a gender quota, which produces more spikes, but in a more sustained and serious way. So on the topic of gender quotas, why did Chile wait so long to adopt gender quotas? You know, in my presentation, I sort of take a very stylized approach to thinking about gender quotas. I say, women made these important arguments around reparations and discrimination, and countries adopted quotas. Well, of course, that's the bird's eye view, but we still have to explain the political processes in every individual country, right? I mentioned, you know, the reluctance in the US to reform our constitution and reform our electoral laws. That's actually not the case in a lot of other places. And so often in individual countries, gender quotas were able to be adopted because they were attached to other electoral or constitutional reforms the country was undertaking at the time. Right. So as the Chilean audience knows, right, Chile made fewer profound constitutional or electoral reforms in the kind of 1990 to 2020 period relative to some other countries. So there were fewer windows of opportunity. And of course, when Chile undertakes its major electoral reform over 2015 and 2016, then that window of opportunity opens in Chile, perhaps a little later relative to other places. And then finally, the question on sort of the advocacy of women and feminists in the United States, and what did what we might call second wave feminism look like in the United States in the 1960s and 1970s. So if you are in national audiences and you have Hulu, I really encourage you to watch the Mrs. America series. It's a wonderful dramatization of this period. And so this was really a period where what was on the table was the Equal Rights Amendment, which ultimately did not pass, but the US women were looking for a constitutional amendment that would state that women and men are equal on the grounds of their sex. And they were looking to remove a lot of the legal and political barriers that kept women out of education, out of the workforce. I mean, in the United States, US women who were married could not open a credit card in their own name until the 1980s. Right, so the focus was very much on striking down a lot of these laws that had discriminatory impact, that kept women out of certain places. And this was incredibly important, but it was very much a movement centered on striking down the barriers the state put to women's success. It was not thinking about creating an affirmative obligation on the state to do things to help women forward. So again, that negative and positive rights distinction.
Well, unfortunately, time is really running out, and this seminar must come to an end. In the name of CPS Board, I want to thank Jennifer and Julieta, also the audience for its participation, and all the institutions which made this possible. We leave you invited to our fourth seminar in May, in which Kevin Partenay from the University of Tours will present his recent book, A Political Sociology of Regionalisms, Perspectives for a Comparison. I also take the opportunity to announce that CPS is organizing its first roundtable next Wednesday, 28th at 9:30 Chilean hour, Chilean time, on the American crisis of democracy, in which Stephen Levitsky, Gisela Sin, and Robert Fishman will discuss the central features of the American crisis of democracy. Jean Simon, who was here with us today, will moderate the discussion. And so we hope to see you there. Thanks a lot to both for this session. Bye-bye.